Hi, I'm Matthew Burchette, and welcome to a special Apollo 50th anniversary edition of Behind the Wings. And we're in Wapakoneta, Ohio, which, as you all know, Ohio is the birthplace of aviation, and some people say that is even the mother of astronauts, because the state of Ohio can claim 25 astronauts. That's pretty impressive. Now, if we're talking about astronauts, why am I in front of this really super cute little house? That's because this house was the boyhood home of none other than Neil Armstrong, the first man to walk on the moon. The other thing that's really interesting is that he used to work for NASA at the Glenn Research Center, which at the time was called the Lewis Research Center. That's just up the road in Cleveland, and there is a ton of information there that I want to check out. So, let's get going. So we drove up from Wapakoneta, and now we're at the Glenn Research Center here in Cleveland. And I've got John Oldham, who's the exhibit specialist here on campus. Thank you so much.
Man.
And I
got to
say, I understand you're actually a fan of Behind the Wings?
Absolutely. Love the show.
Awesome.
Buddy, great job.
Got to get that plug
great
in.
Job.
You heard
Always.
Him here. He said we're doing a great job. So tell us a little bit about what Glenn Research has done for the Apollo program.
Sure. Well, firstly, the Glenn Research Center started as the Lewis Research Center. It was an aero center back in the 40s. We didn't become Glenn until 1999. That was in honor of John Glenn, hometown guy. And but in the interim, as Lewis Research Center, we were faced with part of the big challenges of Apollo. One of the things Glenn had been, or Lewis had been working on at the time, was hydrogen fuels. Basically, we had to push a 363-foot tall, 7 million pound rocket and get it to 17,500 miles an hour in less than 100 miles.
Wow.
So the fuel problem was solved by the folks at Lewis with hard work, dedication, and they were the kind of the spear point of getting hydrogen under control that would later be used to enable us to do some missions. So there were 16 missions that flew prior to manned missions to the moon that Glenn was involved with, spacecraft like the Ranger spacecraft. Rangers were lunar probes that were not quite capable of soft landing. They made hard landings, we'll leave it at that, on the moon. They sent back some very nice pictures on their way in. And in addition to that, we had lunar orbiter spacecraft that would stay in orbit around the moon and provide great photography and some data to help us kind of pick those spots where we would put ourselves eventually on the moon.
All right, John, you have a amazing set of toys, but this?
Yeah,
come
this is
on.
The real deal. Yeah, so what we have here is an Apollo A7L. It is the basic suit to go to the moon in. This particular suit belonged to William Anders, who was the command module pilot for Apollo 8.
Wow.
It was not a flown suit. It was his flight spare, you know, bolt for bolt and stitch for stitch, identical in how they were made. They were form made for the astronaut. In this particular suit, you could not sit down. There's no stitching in there to allow you. If you remember Apollo 11, when Neil and Buzz landed, they were standing. When you landed in a lunar module, you were not sitting in a chair. There was no chair in the lunar module. So you couldn't even bend all the way because it would require things that would compromise the safety of the suit to the point where they decided to delete that.
So on the helmet,
yes.
This does not look like the helmet that you see in all the photographs.
Sure. A lot of people believe that big, beautiful helmet with the gold visor was the actual pressure helmet for the moon. It wasn't. You have this pressure bubble that keeps this astronaut breathing nice breathable air. You don't want to take that out on the moon and take the chance of tripping and breaking it. If you had a hard hat, you could put over that, which is what they had. They called the Apollo helmet the LEVA, the Lunar Excursion Visor Assembly. And it was a hard hat that went over this and had a series of visors, that gold visor that would lift. So that was over the top of this bubble. So you still required this.
Can I try that on?
Absolutely. Sure, we can make that happen. So you'll want to tilt it back and then back over your head just like that.
Ooh.
There you are.
I love it. I sound like really cool in here.
Besides this super awesome spacesuit, John had one more Apollo artifact to show me.
Let's dive in.
But before we get to that, let's talk a little bit more about what's currently going on at Glenn. As one of 10 NASA research centers around the country, Glenn is situated on 350 acres of land and contains more than 3,000 personnel. And their primary purpose is to research, develop, and test innovative technology for aeronautics and spaceflight. Want an example? Check this place out. This is the Simulated Lunar Operations Laboratory, also known as the SLOPE Lab. In here, scientists and engineers are trying to figure out a better way for us to get around on other planetary surfaces, which explains the giant sandbox in the center of the room. It also has a collection of pretty unique tires. They have exact replicas of the tires used on the lunar rover, which were surprisingly light. And the newer models will support much heavier lunar and even Martian vehicles. Another lab doing interesting work is the Exercise Countermeasures Laboratory, which evaluates exercise devices that astronauts are using in space. This lab simulates the zero gravity of space by hanging test subjects from the ceiling and having them run on this vertical treadmill. Unfortunately, I wasn't allowed to test it out, but I did get to try on this super cool harness that was developed at Glenn and is used by the astronauts in the International Space Station. Ever been told, it's not rocket science? Well, this lab is rocket science. Specifically, it's the Electric Propulsion and Power Lab, which, like the name implies, tests electric propulsion. They're currently testing thrusters in these huge vacuum chambers that will ionize xenon gas and make it into a plasma that's thrust out the back of a spacecraft to propel it forward. Like I said, rocket science. Back with John because he's dying to show me something, and guess what? It's Apollo moon rocks!
So the first rock I want to show you is a rock from Apollo 15. So Whoa. This rock has a name. Its name is 15058.192. The 192 is a section of that sample. So this rock was sectioned off into multiple pieces, and this piece was separated from those pieces. So keep in mind, picked up in the vacuum of space on the moon, and the only atmosphere on Earth this rock has ever seen is nitrogen. We use nitrogen as an inert gas to keep from reacting with any of the minerals in that rock. And these pieces were sealed in this material called lucite. My mom used to wax the kitchen floor with lucite floor wax, right? Similar kind of material, but that's 50 years old. It's been in that material for 50 years, so it's protecting it and has not seen our atmosphere.
And this came from Apollo
15. So that is a Jim Irwin rock. Jim Irwin is the actual astronaut who picked up that rock.
Thanks, Jim.
The rock I'm going to show you now is quite different, and it was kind of special even among moon rocks.
Ooh.
So this is a sample from Apollo 16.
Whoa.
This is lunar anorthosite. And an anorthosite represents the older parts of the moon. That's 4.2 billion years old. And the biggest surprise we found in these two samples, and consistently in all of the 842 pounds we brought back, 40% oxygen by weight. The moon is full of oxygen. It's mineral oxygen. It's going to require some work. It's going to take some chemistry. It's going to take some physical and mechanical processes to do that. But it's loaded with oxygen. So.
We have seen some amazing things here on the Glenn Research Center's campus, but now we're talking to Dr. Janet Cavandi, who flew on STS 91, 99, and 104,
correct,
a full-fledged astronaut. Thank you so much for being here.
It is my pleasure.
So Glenn is one of 10 research centers scattered throughout the country. What percentage does Glenn play in this whole overall kind of push to get back to the moon?
There are, you know, maybe four centers that really push the space side, and that would be the Johnson Space Center, the Kennedy, the Marshall.
Right.
And then we are probably next with contributions to space flight.
Well, you guys are kind of important. You're doing propulsion.
Yeah, the propulsion part is kind of, so there's two kinds of propulsion too. There's chemical propulsion. So if you see the vehicles launch off the pad, there's a lot of fire and smoke, right? That's Marshall's specialty.
Okay.
And what we do is the electric propulsion system. So I believe you saw.
We saw that earlier.
Yeah, electric
which is
propulsion,
really
which is
cool
xenon.
Stuff.
Yeah, low thrust, but very, very energy efficient.
That is really cool. Now on the space side
on
of things,
the space
you
side.
You've got Orion working.
We do.
The Gateway.
Yes.
And who knows what else?
A lot of stuff. So let's start with Orion.
Okay. Okay.
So with Orion, we have a new crew capsule that will go back to the moon. Under the capsule where the crew sits, there's a module called the service module, and the Glenn Research Center is responsible for that. And it is actually manufactured in Europe, in Bremen, Germany, by Airbus. And then they have shipped the first element to the Kennedy Space Center. It's being integrated with the crew capsule. And then we will bring that whole integrated stack here to the Plumbrook Station out in Sandusky, Ohio, and we will do vacuum testing on that module in the world's largest vacuum chamber. So it's very important to make sure that we test this vehicle properly to make sure it doesn't have any flaws so that when we put humans on it for the first time, that it will be safe for them to fly.
Do we have kind of a rough estimate of date when that might happen?
Yeah, the equipment will come here this fall and test here, and then we will ship it back, and we should be able to fly by the end of 2020.
So that's the unmanned mission?
That's the unmanned mission.
Okay, and then between unmanned to manned will
be? Yeah, it will be a couple of years probably in between. And in this case, we want to put humans on the moon, but we're doing it to stay for longer periods of time, and we're going to do a lot more science. Learn how to build habitats on the moon, how to protect ourselves from radiation, how to grow food on the surface of the moon, and just, you know, be sustainable, because what we learn there, we can take and put on Mars at a future date.
Talking with John, he showed us some moon rocks, mm-hmm. and I asked him if I could have one, mm-hmm. and he so rudely said no, but since you run the joint, can I have a moon rock?
No. Even if I were able to give you one, I would not give you one. I can't have one.
That's right.
So
you come first.
One, right?
All right,
yeah.
Fair enough. If you're hold on. The awesome drive from Wapakoneta to, say that fast, this is gonna happen a lot.
That's okay. Am I allowed to do that too?
Oh, absolutely. Trust me. Right. Trust me.